Hey guys, Tyra here, bringing you A1 for you on today. We are on Arnhem Checkpoint, playing Futé spawning in the south. We have Henke Jumper playing as Austere, and his loadout is Mechanized Assault, Jaeger Armor, and Mobile Defense. I'll probably expect to see Mechanized Assault. And in the north, we have Lyconius playing as US Forces, and his loadout is Rifle Company, Heavy Cavalry, and Tactical Support. Lyconius currently ranked about rank 50 as US Forces, and Henke Jumper about rank 35 as Austere. Pretty close match. And we see a double re-echelon start, and with that he's managed to secure this garrison right here. However, I believe there's only one window facing in the direction of the machine gun, so it can win that engagement. Well, these pioneers are soaking up a lot of damage in return, and it looks like the riflemen are going to jump in. But I don't think they're going to have much more success, honestly. In fact, that rifle's not even shooting for some reason. It doesn't look like it. This machine gun's just having a field day right here. So Lyconius getting very aggressive, but this machine gun's just doing the business. Meanwhile, that other re-echelon has been capping up the fuel. Well, so Henke Jumper is concentrating everything into this point, but it's paying dividends. Inflicting a lot of manpower bleeding. This could be a wipe here, especially as he crosses the... Oh no, I thought that was negative cover there. Okay. That's weird. Why is that light cover there? Negative cover there. Okay. Well, it is. And that's probably why that squad didn't die there. Here we're seeing a mortar coming in for Lyconius. It's a good decision. There's so many garrisons on this map, and of course that mortar is incredibly powerful. Oh, we've got incendiary rounds popped here by Henke Jumper. Probably wouldn't be using this this stage. He's had so little munitions income so far. Probably want to save it for maybe Faust or medics. I know it's only 15 munitions, but I mean, when you haven't secured your munitions point yet, and you as Austere, who traditionally do have munitions problems in the early game, does all that up. As for Arnhem, I generally veto this map with everybody except for Soviets. So. I already know what to expect, personally. I just feel like, you know, US Forces and OKW don't have flamethrowers unless you go specific commanders, so that's why I'm not really a fan of it with them. And, Brits, same thing. Don't have flamethrowers. And Austere, so many buildings, and generally allies do better on maps with lots of buildings. So that just leaves Soviets, and this could be the end of the machine gun here. Super low health. He's gonna try to chase it. Give it a run and gun. Here come the re-echelons from the side, vaulting the fence. But he's running down the ditch, not down the road. And that looks like it made the difference. Look at all this territory that has been captured up by Henke Jumper. He's been doing some pretty good work, also getting some harass to Lyconius' fuel. And he's gone very, very heavily into tier 1. Quite rare that you could see this from Austere. And I mean, if you were up against somebody like DevM, this really wouldn't work, because as you can see, look how late his tech is as a result of this. And DevM probably would have had a M20 about now, but M20 is not as popular with US Forces players these days, because of course going for like 4 rifles and the Stuart is so powerful. Sometimes players neglect to get the M20. Well, that is of course rifle company, so that's why Lyconius did go for the double rear echelons. So he could get those flamethrowers and perhaps a minesweeper on the other one. Oh, and those flamethrowers dishing it out here, getting that rear echelon squad a lot of veterancy. And he torches that squad down. Oh, I don't know about that. Very risky to stick around for that long. He paid the price, so that's... Oh, no, but he gets the rear echelon with his... Was it with this squad? Oh, it looks like they died on retreat there. Wow. Okay, wipe for wipe. Grandy's been more expensive, but of course they lost him the flamethrower, and here's the first flamethrower now for Henker Jumper. We'll be delaying his medics, and he does have quite a few low health squads.
The squad of pioneers has arrived.
Now he's going for a second squad of pioneers. Facing off against Rife Company, don't have to worry about mines, so this may be double flamer. And this mortar hasn't really got too much done so far. This round, I mean, this cutoff is just so brutal on this map, man. I reckon that the Norse spawn on this map is too hard.
Captain just took the battlefield.
Look at that. What's that guy up to? Oh my god. Spinning around like crazy. And you can see that's why Lyconius keeps getting cut off. On his side, you know, trying to approach his cutoff, there's all this negative cover. And nothing for him to stand behind, really, to protect it. Whereas on this side, you know, there's not negative cover as you approach your cutoff, really. I mean, that's quite far away. And then there's all this heavy cover that you can use to defend it. Which is why the north on this map is quite a bit worse, I feel. Just that cutoff is so punishing. Well, there's the captain for Lyconius. Doesn't have enough munitions for the bazooka quite yet, and there's the 222. Quite late though, 8 minutes. Of course, as I was saying, his tech was delayed because he went so heavy into tier 1. But he may be about to pick this rifleman off. Depends sometimes if the 222's machine gun fires, as you can see. Quite often doesn't. Slightly bugged. Basically the only thing that's makes the 222 not completely ridiculously overpowered for its cost. That is the bazooka for the captain, so now he's going to be able to keep some squads back in. We did see a new rifleman squad for Lyconius. So he's spent a lot of manpower rebuilding that. I mean, this is just like a really large army for this set of the game, especially considering that he lost one of his rear echelon squads. By comparison, Henker Jumper lost one of his grenadiers, and his army's much smaller. Of course, thanks to those free squads. Oh, is there a gap there? Looks like there is. I always thought that that was blocked for some reason. Getting quite aggressive with this 222, but here comes the bazooka. I'm not going to kill him. Perhaps if that mortar shell landed directly on top, it would have been the end of the 222 there. But that is not the case, and Henker Jumper, despite having the smaller army size, just keeps diving for this cutoff and having a lot of success. But here comes the Stuart, and that's probably going to turn the game on its head. It's gonna take care of this machine gun. In fact, this could quite easily be a wipe. Oh, he kind of overcooks it there, drives around, stopping the gun for firing for quite a long time, but has to retreat through these two squads, and that was a wipe. That was the Flamer Pyo. These squads coming around this side, so not gonna be able to pick up that machine gun. And Stuart very late to chase, so a little bit of miss micro there by Lytonis, but he ends up picking up the squad, so can't really blame him. And there is the Puma for Inca Jumper. Oh, but he picks up the mortar. Will he be able to steal it? Stuart's there trying to protect it. He's got a three-man squad, so can't pick it up with this. Wants to pick it up with this one, and that's why Lycoris is focusing it with that. There he goes, he pops the, oh not that, the shell shot, the stun. But he pops smoke to avoid that, and is he, no he can't cap it, this squad did lose one model somewhere. Looks like he's gonna have to just kill it. In fact, they're both trying to kill it. Yep, so Hinky Jumper felt like he couldn't, well, that just disappears. Doesn't even leave a weapon wreck, that's interesting. Enemy armor's chewing us up. Stuart coming forward once again with the shell shock, but he pops it a little bit too early. Now he's got to face the Puma without the shell shock. We could have won that, but the bazooka was there for support. Would have been a dicey one. I don't think one more shot would have killed the Stuart from that amount of health, so probably the right decision to back away there. Oh, but down goes a rifle squad on the flags. Man, some kind of sloppy play from both players here, losing squads unnecessarily. This is the kind of stuff you don't really expect to see in the top 50 rankings.
Our supply line just got cut off.
Going for another machine gun. Guess he feels safe after destroying that mortar, but no. Another mortar on the way for Lyconius. 222 runs straight into the bazooka, gonna have to back away. Got a lot of squads coming down the right hand side now. No more harass onto his cutoff yet. He's got a green leader squad heading in that direction. But yeah, this amount of riflemen should be able to overwhelm this lone Grenadier, even with the LMG. Puma trying to do some damage here, but needs to keep his distance. Can't afford to take the anti-tank grenades. Ooh, Stuart exposes his rear armor to the 222. Bit of a misplay there. And the Flamer almost took down that squad in the garrison, not quite. One more burst and that would have died. Wonder if he maybe should have stuck around. I'm not sure if they got pinned or what. But well, yeah, one more burst would have taken down that machine gun. Perhaps it would have been worth sticking around. Oh, he's going for another mortar. Oh, this is disappointing to see. This is really disappointing.
Mortar team, ready for orders.
Personally, when I play, I try to just, you know, I'll use the mortar if I'm playing lieutenant strategy. Yeah, I just feel like it's so, you know, I just feel dirty using it, you know, it's just so good. I just feel like I don't really deserve those wins if I just play like captain and get the mortar. Well, nice machine gun positioning there, force away that squad, should allow Hinky Jumper to recap his half of the map. God, these text messages. Put my phone on silent, eh?
The capture point is being overrun.
Well, Stuart came forward, took a hit. It's gone back. Puma's still sticking around on Prato's vehicles, not firing. The squad got bombed out so fast by the double mortars. But Rifleman also forced off this side. We got some ES mines going down onto the fuel. I mean, not the fuel, the VP. And oh, we're seeing a sniper. Pretty much dead even in the VP game as well. Very close match in that respect. So interesting to see these going for a sniper. I'm not sure if I would have gone for a sniper in this situation. Probably, I mean, I'd almost never get a sniper, honestly. Don't really enjoy sniper gameplay, but tactically is a good decision, I'm not sure. Stuart's still on the field, could be able to could chase it down. Of course, when you're facing off against double mortars as well, I mean, they are a pretty good counter to the sniper. Sniper, of course, has, what, 82, 83 health, so it can't get one hit by the mortar, which does 80 damage. But when you've got two mortars, I mean, there's a very good chance the two shells will land quite close, especially if it's US forces mortar. It's laser guided accuracy. Got a lot of machine guns. MG42 is just pummeling that squad in the house. Iconius, having not gone for armor company, of course, has to tech. Which is a bit of a rarity in a competitive 1v1 game. So that's why he doesn't have any tanks. So he has got his major on the field. He's getting quite close to the Easy 8. But the Puma's also getting very close to Vet 1. And once it gets to the target weak point, it does have quite a lot of utility. There is the P4 command tank. At this stage, not much like Iconius can do against it. Man, it looks like a lot of damage being dealt to the weapon there by the P4 command tank. All these squads just running forward, so I guess he hopes to get an anti-tank grenade off. Leading a lot of manpower though. And there's the machine gun and the sniper. Oh, Iconius taking a lot of damage there. Pops the on me from the captain to break their suppression, get out of there, but very expensive in terms of manpower. Oh, he could lose his vetted up rear echelons here. Oh, that was close. And those double mortars just raining death on all these garrisons. He's got to be careful standing around here. Stray mortar shell could land on a sniper. There he goes, backing away with it. And there's a mortar in return from Henka Jumper. Kind of late, honestly. But yeah, I can kind of understand. Pop smoke, but it doesn't matter. He stuns both these tanks. S mines almost do the friendly fire damage, take down the Puma, and there it goes. And this shell shock so broken. Look at that. Stuart takes down that all important Puma, which really Henka Jumper needed against the incoming Easy 8. Man, a lot of machine guns, a lot of action. Whoa, that squad just died in one flame burst. It was on three men, but super low health. Carnage. Iconius pushing back onto the map and coming on strong. Got double flamers once again. And Henka Jumper suffered some massive casualties.
A capture point is being overrun.
Here comes Stuart popping the shell shock again. Still no pack from Henka Jumper. He's going for another Puma. Oh, this is a mistake. Well, no, he needs to go for another Puma, but he needs a pack as well. Perhaps he's thinking, well, with double mortars on the field, can I even keep a pack alive? Maybe he's just going to go full Von Ivan styles and spam 3 or 4 Pumas. Which can work. As we saw against Jove and the Warpen champs. We go Faust, just trying to slow the Stuart down. Perhaps he could rotate with his Puma. There it goes. This could be the end of the Stuart, just in the nick of time as well. Just before the Easy 8 hits the field, he's got the fuel for it now. Puma needs to get 2 more hits off here. No, misses again though. And now with all these squads coming forward with the 3 of the anti-tank grenade and the bazooka, has to back away. That was unfortunate. 2 shots from the Puma miss. Now it's the Stuart to get away, and that was, yeah, as I was saying, a critical time. Just before Lyconis gets his Easy 8 out, if he could take down that supporting Stuart, that would have been a really important victory. Rifleman gonna toss a rifle grenade over the house. I mean, over the fence. Only get 2 of the 4 models though. Oh, but he's gonna just find this forward retreat point here. Not much he can do against that many squads though. Pioneers have a lot of repairs to do. He's got a lot of manpower as well. I'm not sure what he's planning on doing with it all. Well, we could do with another squad of Pioneers for the repairs and a flamethrower. He still hasn't upgraded this squad with another flamethrower, which is kind of surprising. Considering the map, though a lot of these buildings are starting to get quite low, especially this one, man. Puma, oh Puma, I think he's going to try find the ambulance. Somehow Lyconius is aware of this. I don't know, why did he drive his ambulance away? Perhaps he saw this through the fog of war, I'm not sure. Lyconius finally has the resources for his Easy 8. He's not building it, I don't know why. Easy 8 will just like completely dominate Hinkajumper Jumper here. That's what it's built to do. One of the strongest medium tanks. Got good armor, good penetration, good mobility, good firing on the move. It's a very strong all-round tank. Stuart charges through the S mines. Gets the stun off on the Panzer IV. It's really just going to do damage to it, not going to kill it. What's he doing with this P4 command tank? He's taking so many bazookas here. What is he doing?
We're losing a capture point.
He did try and rotate the Puma around to maybe flank the Stuart, but it obviously didn't work.
Crowds have cut our supply line. Frontline units are being hung out to dry.
Once again, though, going for the cutoff. And there we go, finally the Easy 8 in production. Very late though, Lyconius could have had this a long time ago. Personally I might have halted reinforcing a couple of my squads just to get on the field. Perhaps about a minute and a half ago. But oh well. See if grenades yet? No. There he goes, gets his anti-tank grenade onto the Puma. Where is the... Okay, he has rebuilt some Pioneers now and they're going to try and do some repairs. Stuart, ooh, comes forward, takes a Puma hit, backs away. Here's the Easy 8 though. So things could go quite badly for Hinkajumper, as I was saying, still has no pack at this stage. Perhaps he's going to have to call in more boomers. I mean, he's got a lot of resources right now. It's not really his issue. Both players have similar sized armies. What bulletin is that? Fuel caches are cheaper. Okay. Wouldn't personally use that ever. Oh, nice. He's getting the better of the attack round through the smoke. But that, oh, there's the end of the Puma. But he's caught in another one. Here it comes. Will he be able to pick up the Stuart here? There he goes. Nicely done. Probably a good trade at this stage of the game. There's a close to Vet 3 Stuart for a Vet 0 Puma. Probably would have taken that trade as well. He's yet trying to hunt down the 222. Pop smoke. 222, similar speed to the EZ8 though. EZ8 is so fast for a tank. Oh, but he misses that shot. Man, that was close. Here comes the Puma now. Oh, this could be the end of the Puma. He just needs to throw the anti-tank grenade here. I think he's going to pop smoke again. It's going to come down to their attack ground battles. And there goes the Puma. Yeah, that was a very reckless play there by Henker Jumper. Got away with the 222, but I mean, this is nowhere near as useful as the Puma. Looks like those mortars going to back away for reinforcement. Lyconia's in a very good position right now. Somehow, I mean, look at this. He's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. This is 8 versus 9. Okay, so pretty similar. I don't know why. I mean, their supply is pretty similar, but I mean, this army just looks so much bigger for some reason. Well, there is the pack. Better late than never. He's going to have to use this in a very defensive position though, because obviously he doesn't want to get blasted down by those double mortars. So it's going to be all about setting up a trap, getting this EZ8 to kind of overextend into his pack. And then maybe once it's taken a couple hits from the pack, then I'll chase it down with maybe one or two Pumas. And he needs to make it happen before Lyconius gets out another EZ8. He needs to take this one down, because with two EZ8s, I don't think Henker Jumper will be able to recover from that. He has gone for battle phase 2, so perhaps he's thinking about teching. The only tank that would really make sense is the Stug, because of course with the EZ8 has such good penetration. Easily beats the Panzer IV, and also has the extra bit of health, so in a straight 1v1, EZ is just far superior. That was the white phosphorus, so I missed it. If it actually hit anything, doesn't really look like it did. Bit of a waste. Personally, I think it's best to try use this on top of a pack when you're kind of going for an all-in push. It is quite expensive, honestly. Oh, I'm kind of surprised the pack didn't get a shot off there. Perhaps he was getting blocked by the smoke. Here he goes. Oh, but he bounces that first shot. That is a very rare sight. I think there's like maybe what, less than 10% chance for the pack to bounce on the EZ8. Something like that. And there's the second EZ8, so that is bad news for Henker Jumper. He keeps getting this cutoff though, as I was saying, that northern cutoff is so brutal. Teller there. I thought we saw another teller over here. No, he's planning one now. And the, oh yeah, there it is. It's got a few tellers around. That is one of the benefits of mobile defense. Not much to spend your munitions on, especially once you've got. Ooh, is that a, was that a teller there? It looks like he's going to use the crit repair. And where's the puma? Okay, that's a fresh puma. Popped it as soon as he saw that run over the teller mine, but thanks to that crit repair, tank gets away easily. But oh man, Lyconius, I don't even realize he's been getting drained on the VPs really hard. Oh, there goes that teller. But now he's got his two easy hits, should be able to just steamroll. Pinky jumper here, he just needs to make a more coordinated push. Like he's kind of just sending his stuff out one squad at a time, or one tank at a time. It's not really working that well. He's got a lot of squads sitting back in his base doing nothing. This is, yeah, not so good. Also lost one of his mortars there. And I'm also very surprised he didn't try chasing and kill that P4 command tank with his Easy 8 just before. Quite easily could have done it here. Well, here come the two Easy 8s coming down this flank. There's that teller mine there. I think the 2-2's trying to bait them over it. And here comes the pack as well. This is what I was talking about, needing to bait these guys into a overextending. Looks like a squad went down somewhere whilst he's micro-ing these tanks, not paying enough attention to his squads. There's the white phosphorus coming down in this region. Second pack joining the party. Oh, this could be the end of the Easy 8s here. It's going to take a Faust. This one certainly should die. Nope, there goes the Puma. He needs to use the smoke. Where's the smoke? Oh, he doesn't have the munitions. The white phosphorus doing a lot of damage to that. Did that just bounce off the rear armor? It looked like it did. And these riflemen, man, they're starting to just like lose these engagements really bad. I feel like Lyconius kind of wasted a lot of his munitions. Never went for weapon upgrades, and it's starting to cost him against these LMG Grens and flamethrower pyos. His riflemen are not really holding their own right now.
The enemy is overrunning one of our capture points.
Especially when you factor in the command tank aura, providing that health buff. Oh, one machine gun did get decrewed. It would be nice for Lyconius to destroy it. Because these things have been causing him a few headaches, honestly. And very important for him. He's getting extremely low on VPs. Really needs to contest the center, and he can't do that with a lot of machine guns hanging around. Rebuilding his rifleman late, so often doesn't end up well, but kind of has to. Honestly, maybe Lyconius could, I mean, it looks like he maybe wants to go for another Easy 8, but maybe he could have gone for the lieutenant. Comes with the bar, and then maybe got a 50 cal of his own to try and help secure the VP situation. Maybe lock, you know, chuck a 50 cal on some of these VPs, lock them down. Currently does not have his mortar to get decrewed. Oh, could this be the end of this captain? Yep, there it goes. Looks looks like he is going to get an anti-tank grenade off onto the P4 command tank. And here comes one of the EZ-8s. Not on prioritized vehicles yet, though. There it goes now. Going to try to get the 222. No, he doesn't use attack ground either. Good thing he didn't chase, though. That would probably have been the end of that EZ-8. And there is, indeed, the third EZ-8. And Hinka Jumper going for the Panzer IV. I don't think this is going to work out too well for him. As I was saying, from Tier 3, I think your best bet is the Stug. Harder to use, but it's, yeah, similar to facing off against the M4C Sherman from Lend-Lease, which also beats the Panzer IV. A straight up firefight. The Panzer IV, you know, does have that bad moving accuracy. So in those moving engagements, US Forces tanks are so much better. Oh, now he's going to expose the rear armor. These Lend-Lease, I mean, not Lend-Lease, these Easy 8s, man. He's just been playing so conservatively with them. He's got plenty of munitions now, so he could pop a white phosphorus. Finds himself in a spot of bother against the PAX, and no, he's derping out hard on that VP. Oh, that resource flag there. There goes the mortar again. That was the Verency on that. Oh no, he's using the white phosphorus in the center for no reason. Oh, this is really disappointing. He could have used it here on this pack, would have been much better. Now he's going after the P4 command tank, second pack facing up. But this should be the end of the Panzer IV. Another EZ-8 coming in from the side. And there goes the P4. All the EZ-8s still alive. These guys flooding in from the side. Clear out that pack. Could be about to clear out everything here. Things going from bad to worse for Hinka Jumper. EZ-8's just steamrolling over everything. There we go. Telemine takes down one of them. Here goes the 222. Here comes a Puma. And a few hits in. EZ-8's getting quite low, they've got to be careful. All the Grenadiers back at base though, so can't have any Faust nearby. But that was nice, by Lyconius. Got, he had, you know, his tanks coming in from three different angles there, and the squad's in support to clear out that pack. And that's what I was talking about, once he made a more coordinated push. Rather than sending stuff in one at a time, he had a lot more success. Hinka Jumper still can get back into this game. Lyconius didn't actually kill either of these packs, so they could be recruit. And Hinka Jumper has plenty of VPs to work with here. Did take down one of those EZ-8s. So he's not completely out of this game, but why was his Puma out so far? Playing very reckless considering the situation. I mean, it looks like maybe he's trying to go for that last 25 VPs right now, but this is not the time to do it. I personally think I would have tried to regroup here, but he's trying to go for the win. 25 VPs takes a while to drain. So this could be the end of his P4 command tank, but maybe not, man, with those skirts bouncing a few shots by the EZ-8s. These things do have about, I think it's what, like 40 penetration more than the regular Sherman on piercing. Oh no, he tried to come back in with the Puma and got taken out there. Greedy, I mean, this is just greedy play by Hinka Jumper. If he just, you know, played a bit more conservatively with that Puma, recruited his team weapons, he would be able to rebuild quite easily. But instead he's going for the VPs, he's trying to drain him out right here. So it's kind of do or die at this stage. And it may be about to work, I'm not sure. Doesn't manage to cap the center. Maybe he's, this one's on the neutralize, so those last 18 VPs starting to drain. This is going to be the end of that squad, perhaps. Aquamantic gonna try chase it. This tank also extremely low. Lycone's trying to cap in the center. Here comes a machine gun. Before command tank. Is this going to be the end of Lyconius? I mean, I thought Hinga Jumper was going to bite the dust here, but maybe not. Perhaps not. He's kind of derping out with this Easy 8 here. What's he doing? He needs to kill these squads. Why is he going after the tank? If he just tried to, like, not derp around here, tried to kill the squad, they'd hopped out with his vehicle crew for the cap. Oh, but maybe you can cap this one. 6 VPs left. He's only on the single drain right now. Ops out with the vehicle crew. 4 VPs left. He's going after that. He's going after that P4 command tank. And he gets it. 2 VPs left. He's got the neutralize, and Hinka Jumper has nothing. Oh, man. That was so close. Oh, that was so close, man. I can't believe this. 2 VPs left. And now he really has nothing. He calls in the Austrian reserves. Probably should have done this a little bit ago. If he had called these in a little bit earlier, as those EZS were chasing his P4 command tank, could have had both these packs recruit. Perhaps could have killed this EZ8. Or perhaps this one that was also very low. But he just made that mad dash for the VPs. Didn't quite pay off. I was trying to put a bunker down. Doesn't have the munitions to upgrade it. He's going to jump inside. Very risky though. If the bunker dies, every unit inside it dies. Which is why it's so much worse than the British trench. Which, of course, when the trench dies, nothing inside it dies. Maybe we're about to see that, or maybe the squad inside's going to die before it even, yeah, before the trench even matters. This guy's trying to do the cap, and he calls the GG there. Oh, man. So, I mean, he went for the greedy play. He tried to drain out the VPs, tried to drain out those last 25 VPs instead of just trying to, you know, recapture his team weapons and play the more safer style. And it backfired on him there, but almost came through there. Nice to see some Easy 8s. Haven't seen these for a long time in a 1v1. And Lycone's gone for that double re echelon, double flamer, which is also pretty cool stuff, but unfortunately also going for the double mortars, which is a bit overpowered. And yeah, maybe, yeah, I think Hinka Jumper just a little bit too aggressive and Well, very close game, very, very fun game. Such a close squeaker of a finish there. Anyway, guys, I'll wrap on that. If you'd like your game to be cast by me, details are in the video description below. Otherwise, I'll catch you all for the next thrilling installment. Goodbye, and good luck.